How many of us really understand what goes on when you text your friend across the ocean and they get the ping almost instantaneously? Allow me to entertain you with a little thought experiment. When you press send on your favorite messaging app, where is your message really going? Into the air, you'd say, like radio waves. But let's back up a bit. When you press send on a messaging app such as WhatsApp, you're essentially sending instructions to your mobile processor via tiny copper wires on a printed circuit board inside your smartphone. Now, these instructions are essentially electrical impulses, right? And electrical impulses are just electrons flowing along the potential difference. How exactly does your message jump into thin air from being electron flows and copper wires? At one stage, you had a circuit board that you could touch and feel and even smell. And then suddenly, you have radio waves in the invisible part of the spectrum, flying away into thin air at incredible speeds. What's in between? Well, an odd-looking device. It's an antenna, which roughly translates to a pole in Latin. An antenna is a metal-tongued voodoo device that swallows electrical impulses and spits out radio waves. It's as silent as the dead, but its screams can be heard for miles. Specifically, a Wi-Fi antenna like the one here in the picture screams at 2.4 GHz, that's more than 2 billion beats per second, and spits out waves of roughly 12.5 centimeters in length. Unlike visible light, these waves can pass through certain materials and even bend around corners. But how does an antenna produce radio waves? Before we answer this question, let's take a small detour. Do you remember the reason buzz in pop science about gravitational waves? They're basically fluctuations in gravitational field propagating as radiant energy. Einstein's general relativity predicted their existence many years ago, and we've only recently discovered them. Just like gravitational waves, electromagnetic waves are fluctuations in an electromagnetic field, propagating as radiant energy. And, not much unlike the story of gravitational waves, the existence of invisible electromagnetic waves was predicted by Maxwell's equation, well before their discovery by Heinrich Hertz. So, to produce radio waves, you need to create fluctuations in the electromagnetic field. And to create those fluctuations, you need electrons moving around in a conductor. The act of radio wave synthesis is a carefully choreographed rhythmic dance of electrons and tiny copper wires. Like perturbations in still water that radiate outward from the point of disturbance, the electron flows in an antenna cause perturbations in the electromagnetic field, which radiates out into space as electromagnetic waves. When you press send on your favorite messaging app, your mobile operating system sets off a chain of events that ultimately encodes the message as a carefully choreographed electron dance. This dance results in rhythmic ebbs and flows in the electromagnetic field in the surrounding space, which radiates outwards towards a cell tower. The receiving antenna on the cell tower feels these ebbs and flows on its conducting surface, inducing an electron dance very similar to the one from the transmitter. This electron dance is again a set of electric impulses in tiny copper wires, which are decoded by the hardware at the cell tower. The decoded information is then carried on high-throughput cables for thousands of miles across countries, continents, and even oceans, through transatlantic communication cables or some other submarine communication cables, to a cell tower near your friend across the ocean. From the tower to your friend's phone is another wireless jump, and finally, your friend hears the familiar ping. How does the phone know where the cell tower is? It doesn't, and it doesn't need to. Your phone broadcasts your message in all directions for anyone to listen to. But don't worry, your message will be encrypted, and only the cell tower can decode your message. How does the cell tower know that the message is from me, I hear you ask? With every message you transmit, you also include a code that uniquely identifies your device. That is how the cell tower knows that it's you. But how does the cell tower differentiate between messages from different phones? The phones all agree on a protocol to send messages to the tower at either different times, different frequencies, different locations, or using different codes. The best analogy I have for this is that of a classroom. Imagine it contains 100 students and just one teacher. Now, if all the students start speaking at once, the teacher cannot understand any of them, so they agree on a protocol. If a student wants to speak, they raise their hand and wait for the teacher to point to them. If multiple students raise their hand at once, the teacher picks them out one by one so that only one student is speaking at any given time. In this case, the cell tower is the teacher and the devices are the students. While students can speak at different times to avoid interference, devices can speak at different times, different frequencies, or different codes to avoid interference. So you're telling me that the majority of the communication is not really wireless? Yes, unless you're using a satellite phone, wireless communication is only used for two steps along the road. Sender to Tower 1 and Tower 2 to receiver. The communication between the cell towers happens through ultra-high-speed communication cables underground. But aren't cables so out of fashion for the 21st century? Why not use wireless all the way? Well, the cables we're talking about here, like the transatlantic communication cables, are definitely very high-tech. They can carry terabytes of data every second and do not face the problem of interference nearly as much as their wireless counterpart. Also, you'll need a lot of satellites to cater to billions of users and their data needs if you want to go wireless all the way, and launching satellites is a very expensive process. That's it for this episode of Tell Me Why. Go ahead and check out our other interesting videos, and feel free to subscribe if you haven't done so yet. Till then, stay happy, stay curious.